saw the news last night and it said foggy day scheduled today. And I am so glad it isn't. So thank you for being here on a beautiful, bright, sunshiny Christmas Sunday morning. It's a pleasure to have you here. If you are visiting at New Hope for the very first time, thanks for coming. There are some district cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to take one and fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by in a few minutes. And we make a promise here at New Hope. We will not beat on your door. We will not pester you on the telephone. But through the mail, we'll send you some information that tells you what goes on around here. We would just love to know that you joined us today. And if you have any prayer requests or praise items or messages to our staff, take the other side of that same card, write us a note, put it in the offering, and we'll see that it's taken care of in the beginning of next week. Please notice there will be a difference in our office schedules for the next 2 weeks. So if you have needs, there's some emergency numbers there, but notice the offices are going to be on some limited schedules for the next 2 weeks. We're going to keep announcements and prayer requests to a minimum today so we can enjoy our Christmas musical and message. But one important announcement is that Wednesday night is Christmas Eve. So on Christmas Eve, we will have our Christmas Eve service here. It's at 9 p.m. It's late enough for those who celebrate Christmas on Christmas Eve to have their celebration and get here. If you celebrate on Christmas morning and you're already in your pajamas with your feet in the bottom, just wear those to church. It's okay. Put a robe on. Okay? Just put a robe over it. The only disclaimer we say is what you can't wear Christmas Eve night is your Victoria's Secret outfit, okay? Apart from that, everything else is a go. We just love to have you. It's a fun night. We have fun with our kids. We play a game or two that kind of draws our attention. And then we end a little bit on a serious note just to get our mind prepared for what the next day really is all about. So 9 to 10 o'clock, we hope you'll come and join us Christmas Eve night. Men, we're going to launch a new Bible study on Thursday mornings from 6 to 6:45 called All In. We've been selling the book here for about a month, and I can't wait till next Sunday to tell you an All In story, to tell you about somebody who's already read the book and has made a significant decision as a result of what God has been teaching them. And so that will be next Sunday. Angel 3 says, thank you for all that you did through New Hope Church. We took care of 245 sons and daughters whose mom and dad are frustrated. So you all did a great job. Great job. That's on top of the over 200 gifts that you sent overseas, all right, to take care of the needs of children in other countries. So thank you so very much for all that you did there. This last Friday night, four of us, two from New Hope and two pastors from other churches in the area, we went in with Prison Fellowship to Pleasant Valley Prison out of Kalinga. We preached on 4 yards to over 300 men that night. What an incredible evening we had in the yard that I was in. Amanda, who you'll hear from this morning, was sick and couldn't be with us. But Lou Rawls took her place. Not the real Lou Rawls, all right? Y'all fell for that one, just too easy. But I had blindfolded you and taken you into a room and had you listen to this man sing, you would have thought it was Lou Rawls. And he led worship for us. And he was awesome. He's an inmate, he's a believer, and he leads worship on his yard every single week. And it was just an incredible experience. And five of those men gave their life to Jesus Christ that night. And so it was incredible. And let me just highlight, also, the musical today is being videoed, all right, especially for if you would like a DVD or even a Blu-ray, you can order one, all right? There's order forms on the table in the back. Pick one up, fill it out, leave it, and they will get those to you, okay? Let me highlight a few prayer requests. Praise items real quickly, though. For those who were here last night, Randy had just gotten word right before our rehearsal at 3 o'clock that his mother-in-law's blood pressure had dropped and she was not doing well. They called for an ambulance. The ambulance got rear-ended on the way to the hospital, and this was just deteriorating quite rapidly. He got texts throughout the evening. She had a heart attack. She didn't have a heart attack. She had a heart attack. She didn't have a heart attack. Finally, about 10 o'clock last night, they sent her home and said, you just need to take it easy for a couple of days. All right? So we are grateful for taking it easy. All right? That was a very good outcome for them. Denise Yoakum, she is a dear friend of a couple in our church, and I had the chance to meet her at a memorial service earlier this year. Denise, she is married, by the way, this is true. Denise is married to Dwight Yoakum. But he works for PG&E. He doesn't record contributions, all right? But that is his name, Dwight Yoakum. Denise had cancer, been in remission for 9 years, and came back this year. She's now under hospice care. Just an amazing lady, incredible, and a wonderful opportunity to spend some time with her and her husband in their home. And this Friday, I went and visited her at their request, and Friday, we sat in their living room, and we planned her memorial service. What an incredible woman. I just want you to be praying for Denise and Dwight as they go through these next few weeks and month or so. Mary Ann, Lisa's mom, continues to improve in the rehab center and hoping to go home before the end of the year. Mike is hoping to be home on Christmas Eve from the rehab center as well. Aaron Stonehouse, our 34-year-old under hospice care, continues to have a wonderful attitude and a wonderful spirit to be praying for her family. This next week will be a very challenging one for them. Naomi Millar, a 94-year-old member of our church who was under hospice care, no longer needs hospice care. She is home with the Lord. 94 years of great life, no regrets, but my prayer request is for her son and her daughter. In seven years, this family has lost their mother and two sisters all between Thanksgiving and New Year's. So this time of year is kind of filled with challenges for them. And so if you remember the Millar family. And then we just got a text yesterday from Marion and Jonathan Hartog, Marion's brother in the Midwest, Tuvis, has just gone under hospice care. And so if you'd be remembering them at this time, they would appreciate that so much. We're going to be asking our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Gentlemen, would you come please? Would you join with me as we pray? And then we will get right into our Christmas celebration. Our Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you so much for the joy that your life brings to us. Father, the difference maker in history was what took place 2,000 years ago in a quiet little town called Bethlehem. But Father, ever since that night, the world has never been the same. And my prayer is that today, a little quiet town by the name of Clovis, that your son that you sent to the world 2,000 years ago will be birthed in the hearts of some men and women today, not only here at New Hope, but Father, as churches gather all around our communities, I pray that your son will be born in their hearts. That the reason you sent the gift 2,000 years ago was so that our sin could be forgiven and our eternal destinations could be changed. We could have hope in this life and heaven in the next. And Father, I pray as a result of the message through music, through fellowship, and through the scriptures today, if there are those in this service in need of a life change, that they will not be ashamed, they will not be embarrassed, but Father, they will be ready for the gift that you give to all of us. Thank you for what you're preparing to do already in our hearts today. The privilege of giving and sharing your faith, and your wisdom to use the resources you give to us for your kingdom's work, we desire that. We commit all this to you in the incredible name of the babe of Bethlehem, your son, the Christ who was crucified, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Wasn't that so cool during the one song when that baby was in a manger and it was moving around? That is so cool. I cried. I was thinking about the Alcornas this week, all right, who actually got to watch that because Debbie's daughter, all right, Brittany, and her husband, Gabe Schroeder, got married right here. They just had a little baby this week, a little boy named Jacob. Right, so it's so exciting for them, and there's a brand new baby right over here. I was thinking about you guys. Wow, it is so cool. Yeah, I'm glad you're here. Let's talk about why we come today. People on a plane and people on a pew, you have a lot in common. All of us are on a journey. On a plane, we're going a long ways. In a pew, we're just simply trying to figure it out. Most are satisfied with a very predictable experience. We like to say, it was a nice flight.
What a nice worship service. Wasn't that a cute Christmas presentation today? We exit through the same door we entered, and we're happy to come next year. But few, far too few in my opinion, are not content with just nice. A few long for more. The boy who passed me on a plane a year or so ago, he asked as he entered the door of the plane, "Will they let me meet the pilot?" The pilot heard it, and he invited him into the cockpit's world of controls and gauges. And minutes later, he emerged out of that door, his eyes wide, and he yelled for everybody in the plane to hear, "Wow, I'm glad I'm on this plane." Nobody else on the plane showed such amazement and wonder as that boy. The middle-aged women carrying beach bags, they were exuberant. They giggled down the aisle. The fellow in the blue suit, he was cranky. I changed suits this morning. I realized last night I was wearing a blue suit. And I'm not cranky. Most on the plane were content to just sit, stare, and say little. Remember, people on the plane, people in the pew have a lot in common. But the boy, he wanted to see the pilot. He probably wasn't going to say at the end of that flight, "Wasn't that a nice flight?" But he would show the plastic wings that the pilot gave him. And he would say, "I saw a man up front." Enter a church sanctuary. Look at the faces. I give you permission. Look. Not just at mine. Look. Look behind you. Look at the faces. A few are giggling. You might even find a cranky one in a blue suit. But most, by and large, will be content to sit, to look straight ahead, and leave through the same door they entered when service is over. But I suspect there are a few of you who you seek more. You've come today and your heart is hungry. You've come today and you want to meet the pilot to find out where we're headed. You want to sense the comforter because your heart has been broken. You want to find the Savior because you've discovered your sins have grown heavy. You've come with childlike enthusiasm and expectancy. Have you thought about why you're here today? More importantly, have you thought about how you'll leave here today? You can sit and stare and say little, but you will leave the same way you came in. My prayer has been for days that the few will become more, and the more will be few. Many songs we sing at Christmas time remind us that Christmas is supposed to be happy. Let me share just a few songs. I wish I could sing a bar or two for you, but I'll just give you the title, okay? That will be better for all of us. How about this one? It's the most wonderful time of year. You know, for a lot of us it is, but for some, it's not. Remember the Millar family? 3 times. 7 years between Thanksgiving and now, they've lost members of their family. How about have a holly, holly jolly Christmas? Yeah, holly and jolly. Wow, has yours been that way? Okay, this one might not be quite as happy, but it's one that just makes us feel so sweet. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Now you know why I'm not singing any of them. Okay, this one makes all of us smile. Jingle Bells, I don't care how old you are, how young you are, you can't help but smile with Jingle Bells. And then I'm walking in a winter wonderland. All of these songs communicate that Christmas is a time to be happy. It ought to be a trouble-free season. But let me ask you honestly. Is that your experience? Maybe not. For some of you, personal problems are keeping you from experiencing the joy of Christmas. For others, you feel like it's just one crisis, one emergency right after the other. And with an avalanche of problems, it's hard to have that holly jolly Christmas sense. Just a few examples in the last few days of this week. Milo and Lisa Perez from our church, the rest of their family. This could be that kind of season for them. It's not holly jolly. For Milo, it would be the first without his mom, caught him by surprise. For Lisa, news that the cancer in her mother's back, going through treatment. That treatment put her in the hospital with an infection, and now she's in rehab, unsure when she'll get home. It's tough. My son Chad works at Clovis East. I did a call from him two Fridays in a row. Dad, could you pray? One Friday, a 16-year-old long boy is killed in a car accident. And the following Friday, another 16-year-old long boy dies in the hospital. Tough for those families. Denise Yoakum, I already mentioned during our prayer time, inviting the pastor over to plan her memorial service 5 days before Christmas. Aaron Stonehouse, 34 years old, under hospice care in a hospital bed in her mother's living room. Some of you have so many little things going on, and some of it's not crisis, some of it is just busy. Is working hard and there's no time for sitting around roasting the chestnuts. Maybe there's not really anything wrong, but for some reason you're just not enjoying Christmas. It's not providing that lift that you had expected. In fact, it's become almost depressing. The world does not look like a winter wonderland. It just looks like a foggy winter day. We call that disillusionment. Disillusionment at Christmas is not an unusual thing. We often get so hyped up with expectations about what Christmas is supposed to be that often the real thing doesn't measure up and we become significantly disappointed. So what can we do today, just a few days before Christmas, that we might avoid or dilute the disillusionment that's already impacted us? How can our level of joy improve? To you, that part of the answer is found for us in the story of Christmas that engages the Magi in Matthew chapter 2. Magi, they're the wise guys from the East. They saw a star the night Jesus was born. It indicated the birth of a new king in Israel. Wanted to honor this new king. Remember, wise guys, they weren't kings themselves. Wise men were king makers. They were the consultants. They were the guys who gave information and wisdom to those who were kings. And based on that wisdom was determined how powerful, influential, and long a king might reign. These wise guys loved to lift up kings. And when they knew that a new king had been born in Israel, they wanted to be a part of the difference-making this new king would make. And they set out on a journey with the desire of honoring the new king with gifts. They set out on a journey following a star to find this newborn king. So whether you're on a plane, or in a pew, or on the hump of a camel, we're all on a journey. From the attitudes of these wise men and the events that surrounded their journey, you and I just might discover a few things to raise our level of joy this Christmas. Three lessons. These lessons will be learned as we answer three questions. First question, what do you seek at Christmas? What do you seek at Christmas? You see, our level of joy at Christmas is directly related to what it is that we seek. Ask yourself the question, what is it I want to get out of Christmas? What is it that would make my Christmas wonderful and satisfying? Would it be snow? Would it be having all the family together and happy? A feeling that we define as holiday spirit? Finding the right present to give? Getting the right present you've been hoping for? By the way, men, just so you know, it's not a lawnmower for your wife. Okay? That's not the right present. Pass me that along. The problem with all these is answers to those questions can still leave us disappointed. Have you ever had that kind of experience when you were disappointed by Christmas because it did not deliver the feeling that you thought it would? I'm going to tell you the news you don't want to hear. The problem is not with Christmas. The problem is in our expectations. We are looking for the wrong thing. The Magi, they show us how to increase our level of joy at Christmas because they went looking for the right thing. And what was it they were looking for? Verse 2, chapter 2, Gospel of Matthew tells us very clearly. They came to Jerusalem and they said, "Where is he? Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and we have come. We are here now to worship him." They were looking for Jesus because of a star. Christmas for them was an opportunity to find and worship Jesus Christ. Here's an interesting question for you. Have you been a star for anybody this Christmas? Have you been a star? Have you been the source that God could use to bring somebody else? Somebody else might follow you to find who? The one who is King. His name is Jesus. God used a star. Have you ever wondered about this? Well, why did God choose a star? Do you want to know one of the key characteristics of a wise man? He was also an astronomer. He studied the stars. They were stargazers. You want to get the attention of stargazers? What are you going to use? Throw a star they've never seen up in the sky. Got their attention. You see, God has some crazy ways of getting people's attention. God is not stuck in a rut about using just one way to get our attention. He finds what floats our boat. He finds what will get us to look his direction. Think about a few of them. Think about the Old Testament. A son-in-law tending sheep on the backside of the desert. He'd sat there day after day after day on a rock watching the sheep down below. One day, a guy named Moses looks across the hillside, and on the other hillside, he sees a bush, same bush he'd seen day after day after day, tending his father-in-law's sheep, and all of a sudden, he sees this bush burn, and burn, and burn, and burn. A dry bush on a hillside won't burn very long. This one just kept burning. So Moses walks over there. Let me check this thing out. And when he gets there, he was in for the shock of his life. That bush not only burned, that bush talked. And I got to be honest, that bush wasn't the nicest bush. Because the first thing that bush said to Moses is, "Take your shoes off, son. God, holy crap." Moses just thought he was on pasture land. God got his attention. Why? Because he had a direction that he wanted Moses to go, and he needed to get his attention. Moses had been stuck in a rut for almost 40 years. You stuck? God said, "Are you here today? Did you follow some star that brought you here? Maybe it was a relative in the choir." God wanted to get your attention. Hey, how about Balaam? Some of you know your Bible. What did God use to get Balaam's attention? Yeah, donkey. Yeah, somebody over here. You use the King James Version. King James Version says ass. Yes, it does. I can say that when I'm quoting scriptures, okay? And he did. I mean, I thought a bush was kind of funny to talk, but how about a donkey? A donkey has to tell its rider the direction it has for its life. How about a voice that comes out of the shade of a planet for a guy named Jonah. Maybe one of the most peculiar ways that God communicated was God wanted to communicate to an entire nation who had been stubborn and strong-willed against following God's leadership. They would love him one day and reject him the next, and love him a week later and reject him the next. And God wanted to get their attention and show them how wishy-washy they were. So what does God do? He gives them a living flannel graph lesson. Okay, last night I had two high schoolers sitting on the front row. Okay. Do you have any idea what flannel graph is? You're the youngest person sitting on this row. Any idea what flannel graph is? Okay, you don't. That takes me off. Because I do. Okay, flannel graph. It was my generation as a child. It was our generation's version of a DVD. Okay? If a Sunday school teacher wanted to illustrate, all right, there was a blue cloth on a board, and they would have cut out figurines that had Velcro on the back of them, and they would stick to the cloth, and they would tell the story, and they would put up the characters, and the bush, and the boat, and so God wanted to give Israel a real-life flannel graph illustration. So God says, Hosea, you're my prophet, you're my preacher to Israel. Go marry a prostitute. God has not been in the habit of telling his preachers to marry prostitutes. But he tells Hosea, go find a hooker. But not just anyone. I could have been content with probably a different one. That probably didn't come out right. Anyway. The one God specifically picked for Hosea, her name was Gomer. You've heard me say this. Some of you have heard me say this before. I got to tell you, it'd be really hard to be romantic and whisper in your wife's ear at night and say, oh, Gomer. It just doesn't work for me, all right? It kind of ruins the mood. But he did. Why? Because Gomer left Hosea 3 or 4 times, and every time Hosea would go buy her back from her pimp, and he would take her home again. And the Israelites kept saying to Hosea, why are you doing that? Just leave her there. Hosea asked God, why am I doing this? He says, you tell the people what they see you doing for Gomer is the very same thing I have been doing for them for decades. They go whoring after other gods and end up in trouble. They call on me and I come bail them out. I want them to see what commitment is all about. God doesn't have official channels for speaking in which he limits himself to. He gets creative, and he got creative with a star. What are some ways that God may speak to some of you in a way that we will understand? Maybe music. Maybe through one statement or phrase. Sometimes God gets our attention when we lose a job. Sometimes God gets our attention because he provides us a job. Sometimes it's the birth of a child that God gets our attention. Sometimes it's illness. Sometimes it's in nature. The wise men, they were looking for Jesus because of a star. And that is what we need to be looking for and expecting this Christmas. We need to experience worship, a fresh glimpse of him who was born King of the Jews. If our goal this Christmas is to worship Jesus, then I doubt very seriously if one of us will be disappointed. Or if we come to worship him, we will leave contented. If you've come for a great musical performance, you might be disappointed. If you've come to hear a great sermon, you certainly could be disappointed. But if you have come to worship him, you will be disappointed. Number two, second question, where do you look? First question was, what do you seek? Second question, where do you look? You see, our level of joy at Christmas is directly related to where we look. We learn from the Magi that there are wrong and right places to look for Christmas. You see, the Magi, when they got within 6 miles of their final destination, they stopped relying on their GPS. That's the original GPS right there, all right? Star of Bethlehem. They got within 6 miles of Bethlehem. They came to a fork in the road. One way was Jerusalem, the other way was Bethlehem, and they made an assumption. They got their eye off of that which was leading them, and they followed their own ingenuity. That can sometimes be very dangerous for us. You see, these were kingmakers. I'm going to see a king. Bethlehem, Jerusalem, where would a king be born? Oh, capital city. Oh, that's where King Herod lives. If a new king has been born, it's bound to be in King Herod's house. We'll go to Jerusalem. And they go to Jerusalem and they say when they get there, where's the king who was just born? Herod didn't have a baby. And now he's ticked because there's competition in the kingdom for his authority. So what do they do? Herod says, hey, you priests, you scribes, come here. These guys say that the Jews have a new king. Where is he? Anytime we get off to, I have an iPhone, okay? And I can plug in my iPhone where I want to go, where I am, and I'm 91% charged up. Okay, good. And anyway, when I put that in my GPS on my phone, if I make a turn differently than what Siri tells me, she says, recalculating, course correction. If I were her, I would just say, hey, stupid, turn around. All right, but she's very gentle about it. But she lets me know, and the farther I go, the more corrections that have to be made to get me to the needed destination. Guess what? Maybe you need a course correction today. You've gotten within 6 miles. You're close. You've been following the star, but all of a sudden you've stopped leaning on the leadership of God, and you've learned to lean on your own understanding. So when the scribes came, you know what they did? They opened up the scriptures and in the book of Micah. They said, oh, you're not quite there yet. Go back to that fork in the road. Go to Bethlehem. That's where the prophecy says the king will be born. See, they looked in the wrong place. He wasn't to be found in Jerusalem. But remember, God does not waste anything. He now put Jerusalem on notice. King Herod knows a new king has been born, and the scribes and Pharisees now know your promised Messiah is here. Isn't that funny? It took wise guys from Iraq or Iran to come tell the Jews the king had been born. Here's also something I find fascinating. Wise men traveled 600 to 1,000 miles to get there. All the scribes and Pharisees needed to do was travel 6 miles. And even after the wise men told them why they were there, not a one of them left Jerusalem to go find Jesus. They missed him by that much. How much have you missed him by? Last question. What do you give? Where do you look? What do you seek? Last of all, what do you give? Our level of joy at Christmas is directly related to our spirit of giving. The Magi came to Jesus' house bearing gifts. And what they gave was entirely appropriate. By the way, you all know this. Most of our nativity scenes are not. I told you God had creative ways to speak to us, all right? The wise men were not at the stable. We show that in all of our nativity scenes. They did not show up. The only ones who showed up the night of the birth of Jesus were shepherds. These guys showed up somewhere from 1 to 2 years later. We know it's less than 2 years because Joseph and Mary took baby to Egypt to escape the slaughter of infants. Somewhere between 1 and 2 years, the wise men showed up. Shepherds were first on the scene. Shepherds, the lowest on the totem pole. Wise men. Top shepherds. I wonder why God did it that way. Because God says, I've come for the down and out. And I've come for the up and out. And anybody in between. I'm for everybody. What were the gifts they brought? They brought gold. That was befitting a king. By giving it, they acknowledged that Jesus was and still is the king. They gave frankincense, and that was a gift primarily for priests, because the priests used frankincense in the temple worship. And by giving it, they acknowledged that Jesus not only was king, but he was priest, the one who would intercede on our behalf before God the Father. And then they gave myrrh, a round gold peculiar gift to give. Myrrh was what you used on dead bodies. Not flattering, does it? And yet this fragrant ointment used to anoint a body before burial. By giving it, they acknowledge at the birth of Jesus that he has come to die for the sins of the world. Incredible. We ought to give appropriate gifts this Christmas as well. Don't get me wrong, I'm not talking about material things, I'm talking about something more important. First of all, we ought to give our life to Christ. If we have already done that, then we should be giving gifts of love and kindness to family and friends. We ought to give the gift of our help to those who are hurting. We ought to give the gift of forgiveness to those who have hurt us. Giving these kind of gifts will result in joyous and meaningful Christmases. God knows shepherds and kingmakers, the Messiah had arrived. And I'm telling you, the Messiah has come, and I'm glad he did. Are you? Let me wrap this up. What are you giving for Christmas this year? Why not, first of all, consider yourself to God? Then time to your family. Then compassion to those who are hurting. Forgiveness to the isolated. I promise you, when you look for the right thing, in the right place, if you give the right gift, you will not be disappointed with your joy of Christmas. There was a missionary team that had been invited to Russia to teach Christianity. It was Christmas time, and as they taught the story of Christ's birth in an orphanage, everybody listened in amazement to the story, for none of the kids had ever heard the Christmas story. None of the staff in that part of Russia had ever heard the Christmas story. And one of the missionaries wrote, "We gave the children some materials and we instructed them to create a manger scene that they had just heard described to them. All was going very well. The kids were doing great until they came to a table where a little boy named Misha sat. He looked to be about 6 years old and his project was finished. And the missionary said, as I looked at that little boy's manger, I was startled to see not one, but two babies in the manger. I called for a translator to come over to ask him, why two babies? Looking at the completed manger scene, the child began to repeat the story he had heard. And he was very accurate until he came to the part where Mary put Jesus in the manger. Then Misha started to ad-lib his own ending to the story. And Misha said, and when Mary laid the baby in the manger, baby Jesus looked at me and asked me, Misha, do you have a place to stay? I told him, Jesus, I have no mama. Jesus, I have no papa. I have no place to stay. Then Jesus told me I could stay with him. So I got into the manger, and then Jesus looked at me and told me he would never leave me. He would never forsake me. I could stay with him forever. Misha then buried his head in his hands, and he wept, and he sobbed. These were not tears of sadness or pain anymore. These were tears of great joy. He had found someone who would love him, who would not abandon him, who would not abuse him, someone who would stay with him forever. Mike Rood sent me a picture in an email this week, and I think it's perfect to wrap up. The picture is a manger with baby Jesus in it. The caption under the manger says this, "Teen-sized bed." There's room for you. Just as there was room for Misha, there is room for you in the life of the family of Christ. We serve a Jesus who humbled himself. A Jesus who became a man so that we could become the children of God. A Jesus who loved us so much that he can change our lives forever. 2 nights ago in prison, I feared that those inmates that I was preaching to would think that they were too bad and too unworthy to receive the forgiveness of God. I'm delighted to tell you, 5 or 6 of them proved me wrong. They invited Christ because they were ready for the intense change that the babe of Bethlehem could bring to them. Today, I have another fear. I have a fear that citizens of America, residents of Clovis and Fresno, might think they're too good to need forgiveness. I was proven wrong Friday night. I pray today I'll be proven wrong again. The Bible says all have fallen short of the glory. Lord God. It is the reason the star led wise men to Bethlehem. It's the reason something led you here today. We need a Savior. Would you invite him in your life if you haven't already? Would you bow your heads and pray with me? You can use your own words. There's no special formula. There's no special set of words. There's just an honest heart that says, God, I'm tired. I need rest. God, I'm frustrated with my willful attitude towards others and my rebellion against you. God, I'm tired of the poor choices I made. God, I'm tired of trying to do life on my own. I need you. Father, I pray, as you have for thousands of years, that you listen to the hearts of those who are here today. If there's a husband or a wife, if there's a man or a woman, a son or daughter, who's sitting right now in the pew, I pray that they won't leave and say, well, that was a nice service. But I pray that some of them will become part of the few who are looking to me for the pilot of their life. The one who can change the destiny of their future and change their eternal location. Father, I pray they'll be honest and say, God, I need you. Oh, God, I'm a sinner, but you're my Savior. I want to climb into your king-sized bed. God, I want to spend the rest of my life. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.